much for the kind invitation. I especially want to thank Leora for inviting me and to tell you more about many new possibilities and exciting possibilities for Heusler compounds. And I have many co-workers, and this is good. Oh, now this works. Okay, so I have to mention that a lot of this work was supported by so-called Aspimat proposal. This was a German-Japanese proposal here with the Tohoku University. And I had many co-workers here from Koki Takanashi, Hideo was also a member, and especially Andro Sensei's group. And my closest collaborator was always Mizukami, who already gave a talk because we were there mainly interested in the manganese-Heusler compound. And I have especially to mention one of my very established old co-worker. He nearly is 80 years old. It's Jürgen Küpper. Some people know maybe the book of him, Magnetism, a theory of magnetism, and he calculated the band structure of cobalt-2-Heusler compounds in 1983, in the same time when the gold was working on half of us, and at the same location, so he was discussing with the gold because at this time it was, and I had other co-workers also in mind. Okay, so you have seen already this slide, and I want to go, since I think everybody is familiar to the Heusler compound, to the hard stuff, and I'm only 30 minutes. So everybody knows the Heusler compound is a very simple structure type. Some people, like Dito Weiss, still think it's complicated, but I think it's very simple. You can understand this part of material as relatives of the semiconductors, binary semiconductors, and this is more or less the reason why you can have the so-called half-metallic band structure for which it was, they are famous. So they are metallic in one spin direction and semiconducting in the other, but you need a family of semiconductors as a starting point. So and then the good thing is with the so-called full Heusler, which have all the tetrahedral sides filled here, is that you have two magnetic sublattices. This is not the case in the half Heusler, because in the half Heusler this atoms don't talk to each other, but here if all the sides are filled, the atoms talk to each other. And so you have now two magnetic sublattices, one which is here normally the cobalt 2 and the manganese, and the other sublattices, for example, in cobalt 2 manganese base. But this gives you many possibilities. So despite of having ferromagnetic Heusler compounds, you can have also ferrimagnetic Heusler compounds. And I have to mention, so there are non-magnetic semiconductors in this family, as you expect. As I said, it's relatives of the semiconductors. So, and one of this, and these semiconductors can be easily identified by electron counting rules, like chemists know that you have 8 or gallium arsenide, people know with 8 valence electrons we have non-magnetic semiconductor. But we can include also p electrons, then we have 18 valence electrons and 24, for example. So iron, 2 vanadium, aluminium, this is also a famous material in Japan, is a very good thermoelectric material and it's non-magnetic semiconductor. So this was for us a starting point when we started to think about Spintronics materials and so on, and everybody was talking about low magnetic moment. So we should go to ferrimagnetic compounds. And how can we design ferrimagnetic Heusler compounds? It's very simple, because we know from the early work of Kübler that you have to have a localized moment at this position, then you force this. If you have manganese sitting here, like in the cobalt 2 manganese silicon compounds, you have heard today about this. This is always magnetic. You can do what you want. If you have iron 2, vanadium, aluminium, which means the iron is sitting here, the vanadium is sitting there, you can even achieve, if you have 24 valence electron, non-magnetic iron. So the Heusler behave more like counting electrons. Okay. So in this case, to make a ferromagnetic compound, we simply use the trick saying, look, if you have manganese sitting here and 24 valence electrons, then this magnetic sublattice has to compensate. This is a magnetic sublattice because Heusler fulfill all the Heusler rules. Okay, so therefore it was the idea. So this was the starting point to make this ferrimagnetic Heusler compound. And indeed, if you assume a cubic ferrimagnetic Heusler compound, you can use a band structure with 24 valence electrons. And one example of many other atoms which you can maybe combine to 24 valence electrons, manganese, gallium, gives this band structure as a half metal which has a zero magnetic moment. So this was the starting point. And one other reason why we worked on this was there was a prediction that compensated ferromagneton bond picked might be high temperature superconductors. So this was the side effect. So we made the material, and we looked also in the literature. Unfortunately, we cannot make it too big. First, we were a little bit disappointed, so it has this tetrachloride distortion. But what is good is that this ferromagnet, and then if it distorts tetrachlorinally, we get a small moment due to the tetrachloride distortion. But the good news was the CC is rather high. This is what you want if you think even about photonic application. And this is not really a CC, it's a transition from the cubic, from the tetragonite into a hexagonite structure. So the phase diagram of the Heusers are a little bit complex. And the reason for this is what we always say, following the Kubler rule, the manganese has a very localized moment in the Heusler, so it has approximately a D4 configuration. So then if you assume an octahedral surrounding with a D4 configuration, you have here two degenerated states, and only one state is occupied by an electron. This causes the Antella distortion, and this lifts the degeneration here of the two states and causes the tetrachloride distortion. So this was the reason. So after we were first a little bit disappointed, so our Japanese friend were very happy because they thought it might be an interesting material anyway for a Spintronics application. So even at this time, we published this a nice material for Spintronics application, not knowing exactly maybe what is the meaning of Spintronics application. And we, at this time, Miyazaki group immediately recognized the impact, and they made very nice film out of this, which shows nicely really that you have a nice out-of-plane magnetization in this material. And this was more or less a starting point. So, but we as a group of originally chemists don't want to start with this, stop with this. So we thought, okay, there must be some cubic Heusler compounds which are manganese rich. And there are other rules how to design Heusler compounds. And so this is like, if we make manganese rich Heusler compound, we can have two structure types, the Heusler structure type and the inverse Heusler structure type. And the big difference is here that we have no central symmetry, which is again interesting for some theoreticians. Okay, because this always makes interesting properties. Okay, so all the Heusler compounds which have manganese 2, this chrome, vanadium, or something on this side, make this structure, because always the most electropositive element goes always to this side. Okay, then the manganese is sitting here, and all the manganese 2 Heusler compound which has atoms on that side make the inverse structure, because then the manganese is the most electropositive element, so for sure it sits here. The other manganese are sitting there, and then the additional iron cobalt or nickel is sitting on this side. So then if you look on the electronic structure of all these potential manganese 2 Heusler compounds, and many of them are made by several groups, so you see also these compounds are sitting in the same way on the theta Pauling rule like the cobalt 2 Heusler compound, which means the manganese 2 and the cobalt 2 Heusler compound has a high spin polarization, with exceptions here of this the late transition method. So this may be also explained by manganese, cobalt to manganese silicon, for example, is very good material for controlling. So now you can imagine, so and some people don't like if we chemists talk about negative magnetic moment, but now you understand why we talk about negative magnetic moment. Because you know we have manganese 3 gallium would have, if it would be cubic, a zero moment, and now I think even Coe's group claims they have made cubic manganese 3 gallium in films, so it would have a zero moment. So all the cobalt 2 Heusler compounds are very nice ferromagnets, okay? And here are other manganese rich Heusler compounds which have even a negative moment, and the reason for this is like the moment here on the manganese side, so is overcompensated by this moments. Okay, so depending on the ratio of this moment versus this moment, we have a positive or a negative moment. But which tells us also, we may even think about a compensated ferromagnet. If manganese 2 gallium doesn't work, we can maybe take another composition of materials simply counting to 24 valence electron and hope that it becomes cubic. And indeed it works. So if you take manganese 2 vanadium gallium, which has minus 2 mu bor plus iron 2 manganese gallium, which has plus 2 mu bor, so it should be a compensated ferromagnet. And indeed, we made this very strange quaternary compound, and this is a magnetic measurement as a function of temperature, and this has a very nice compensation. So you see, at 5 Kelvin, so you have the nicest freezes. At 125 Kelvin, it's flat. And then at 200 Kelvin again, you have the nicest freezes. And this is the electronic structure. So it's a zero-moment compensated cubic fermion. Okay. So and this are Hall measurement, which shows also you see really no Hall anomalous Hall effect. Very small moments in general, you have to remember later, okay, in this material. And also the Hall measure went really nicely with the signs, which gives us more encouragement to talk about negative magnetic moment. Okay. So this is not the only system. So in collaboration with Mizukami's group, we took manganese 3 gallium, and since this has not now 1 rubor, but minus 1 rubor, we put a little bit of cobalt into this and looked also for the compensation point. And here you see we nicely can drop the magnetization and we nicely can increase the coercive field up to 2 tesla. And manganese 3 germanium is also nearly compensated, so we talked about this today too. And there's another system on which my Corey is working and he likes it very much and he had a lot of trouble to get it published in PRL because he doesn't have 24 valence electrons. He has 21 valence electrons. So there was a fight with referee why suddenly this Heusler doesn't follow the rule. But if you look carefully, I think I have the next slide. So if you look carefully, this compound has a composition manganese 2, ruthenium 0.5 gallium. And then everybody understands it simply follows the 18 plus 24 divided by 2 rule, so you have to have 21 valence electrons to get the compensation point. So if I would have been the referee, I would have accepted. As I mentioned before, there are many like 18, 8, and 24 non-magnetic semiconductors. So how many understand the magnetic properties in this cubic manganese-rich Heusler compound? As I said, on the octahedral side, and this here is, for example, manganese 2 cobalt gallium, so the moment is always high. So it's around 3 or even higher rubor. Okay, so the atoms on the other side, the cobalt gallium, and so always just has a moment, maybe in cobalt it even has a slightly higher moment to fulfill the theta tonic group because Heusler like to fulfill. If the manganese is sitting here on this tetrahedral side, the moment is slightly lower, and only in case of the inverse Heusler compound, the moment also in this side becomes larger. But what can we learn if we look for the effective exchange coupling? In case of cobalt to Heusler compound, it was always ferromagnetic positive. And here you see, in case of manganese Heusler compounds, manganese-manganese interaction between these two manganese on different sides is always antiferromagnetic. So if we want to make a more ferromagnetic compound, we have to work on this position or reduce, for example, this position. And this is what people do who work on manganese 2 minus X Heusler compounds for the reason simply to reduce or increase the moment. So there's all kinds of possibility to reduce the moment, increase the moment, for all different applications, if you follow the rules. And the Curie temperatures for the cubic Heusler compound are rather high in the late transition method compound because you have the strong magnetic interaction between the two manganites here. And for manganese 3 gallium, it's predicted very low because it's much better if it's stable. Okay, so then one more or less accidentally we recognize that manganese 2 cobalt aluminium is a so-called spin gap semiconductor because if you look for the band structure, you see you have wide band gap in one spin direction and you have nearly zero band gap in one spin direction in the other. And this was predicted by Van et al., by himself or one person, Kuan, that this should be very interesting for the from the viewpoint of topology, etc. So we made this compound and did more series. So since we like to calculate baryt curvatures, since we're in the business of topological insulators, we look for the baryt curvatures and we know that we can get information about the anomalous Hall effect. So we did all of this, and here we show the measurement of the material, so it has a kind of semiconducting slope. Here's the charge carrier concentration we get from the Hall. Measurement is 10 to the power of 17. It has rather high Tc because it has a lot of magnetism in there, and it follows the Slater Pauli rule, so it has 26 valence electrons, and we measure exactly 2.4. And here is Tc. So, and the unharnessed Hall effect is really a nice agreement with the theory. It's not very large. But for 2.4, it's okay, and it's exactly what theory predicts. So it seems to work also very well. So then there was a nice paper of Galanaki's group, and I want to draw your attention to this, especially the people who like Magnetism, so Gabriel Martin, there are even, so far not experimentally made, many semiconductors. If you see here, for example, cobalt, tubulidium, scandium, silicon has a 300 mini EV band gap. So again, we can identify many of these candidates, and it looks like again we can count electrons. So simply to see, so with 18 valence electrons, we fill up the S, P, and D bands. Then, if we assume we have magnetic ions, so the first D bands I draw here in a splitted way to make it more clear. So if we fill up the T to G bands, we end up with 21 valence electrons, and this is an example for 21 valence electrons. It's a ferromagnetic semiconductor, and this would be a ferromagnetic semiconductor with a calculated Tc also around 600 or 800. Then if we fill up, put more electrons in 3, so we end up with a non-magnetic semiconductor because then it's non-magnetic. But then two additional electrons, sorry, this is moved here. We have 26 electrons and 28 electrons still as a ferromagnetic semiconductor, or again, ferromagnetic semiconductors, which might be, I think, some other potential ferromagnetic semiconductors. So there might be even more space also to look for ferromagnetic semiconductors with high Tcs in this compound. So this was the main reason also for us to buy an NBE machine and try to make this. So, but the cubic Heusler compounds are not always cubic. You can distort a Heusler compound. So, you can stretch it along the 100 direction, and you end up with manganese 3 gallium. In reality, it's heterogeneously distorted. But you could also stretch it along the 111 direction, and then we end up with this hexagonal. So, therefore, this explains why we have very often in this material a competition between the three structure types. So the high temperature structure, for example, for manganese gallium and manganese germanium is this structure type, but they are anti-ferromagnetic. But there are also ferromagnets with this structure type, like iron 3, germanium, and iron 3. So this means if we take into account structural distortion, we have even a very big playground. People know the space transition between the cubic and the tetragonal. It's interesting for shape memory, now it's all magnetic calories. Okay. So simply this is, I maybe skip it more or less. It says simply that if we calculate the cubic band structure for all examples we have, we always have a nice peak in the band structure and the band gap in one direction, but this peak causes a Gantella distortion. You can see it even from the band structure. This is a cubic band structure, and then this is a tetragonal distorted structure, so you reduce this density of state, but unfortunately you get also some density of state in the band. So all these manganese rich Heusler compounds have not 100% spin polarization, most of the time still a high spin polarization, because the rearrangement of the electrons doesn't close, it closes the gap or makes it smaller gap. And then what happens with the they show a deviation from the Slater Pauli rule, and so you simply can say manganese 3 gallium sitting here goes a little bit down, so it has around 1 micron. So the tetragonal line of the Slater Pauli rule is slightly shifted from this. So now we could even think here also to think about compensated compounds by simply thinking how to combine here two systems around the 0 point. Okay, so what happens in case of the tetragonal Heusler compounds? So there's not a big difference if you see here the cubes are the cubic Heusler compounds, the square ones are the tetragonal Heusler compound. So for some, you have a strong deviation like the iron compound, so the tetragonal shows really a very strong deviation from the magnetic moment changes. But it's more or less the same that in case of the manganese on this side always has a high magnetic moment. On the tetrahedral side, the moment is first lower and then it becomes higher. So the tetrahedral distortion doesn't change so much. In some cases, here's the Curie temperature, it goes to higher Curie temperatures. In some cases, like here, the manganese regalium has much higher Curie temperature. And this is the lower limit, this is the DFT calculation, normally the experimental values are even higher. So, what we found also out is that some of Heusler compound like rhodium 2 show in plane magnetization, not all of them are out of plane magnetized. So this is also explainable by DFT calculation. So there are many more out of plane magnetized Heusler compounds if they are the tetragonal distorted one. But then if you go to higher electrons numbers, but here you lose also the pseudo gap or the gap, so you can have in plane magnetization. But you see also, depending from 3D going to 4D to 5D, the best is to have the heavy elements, so spinorbit coupling helps really to get a very, very huge magnetical soil and anisotropy for a nice out-of-plane magnetization. But you see also some of the compounds are lying on the borderline. Because so far we only have recognized collinear magnetism. So there are two ways to really get a high magnetical soil anisotropy. One was what I explained before, was the antenna distortion, so it seems to be in some sense a certain electron counting number which is good to have this antenna distortion, but the other tuning parameter which we have and which might even have a bigger influence is spin-orbit coupling. So if we go to heavy elements, we can have this spin-orbit coupling. Okay, so now here also in the tetragonal, similar like the cubic, we again could go to a compensation point, look what is happening if we make a material which is just compensated. And one example is manganese regalium doped with platinum. It stays cubic and it's compensated. And this is the work of Adaya. So he even looked for this compensated ferromagnet and he looked what is the influence if I have a little bit of disorder in my singing crystals on this compensated ferromagnet. And you can imagine, so you get really big positivities. I have to say these are 30 Tesla, so we have to go to the high field lab, and these are more than 6 Tesla. So for this material class, if you look into the compensation point, you get really nicely, and this is a very typical hysteresis curve for such a compensated ferromagnet in this tetragonal. You get both, you get this behavior like it looks like an antiferromagnet, but it has to be hysteresis here of 6 Tesla. But since we have this disorder, we can tune the hysteresis also in one direction. So this was interesting for him because he liked this exchange bias effect which you see then in this material. So the referee didn't like to work on platinum because it's expensive and it has a TC of 410. It has a TC of 410 and we wanted to set it also as a starting point for rare earth free hard magnet. So we made the same material with iron, and iron even has still a huge porosity field at room temperature. So after we thought about, okay, is everything nice in the world of Heusler by having collinear magnetism, we have ferromagnetic, we have ferromagnetic, we have antiferromagnetic, so we can make compensated ferromagnets, but we would like to have more exciting physics even beyond this collinear magnetism, and maybe even scurrious, because we have no central symmetric and we have Jaruzinski Maruja, maybe due to our global conservatory, you know, inversion center, and then additionally we can have spin-orbit coupling. And I attended a nice meeting at the STT Round Forum in Paris, where Stuart and Albert were heavily discussing whether we can use fermions for racetrack. At this time, Stuart simply said, okay, we can accept fermions if we define it as double domain mode, and you'll see later. Okay, so everybody knows what we need for spin-mutes, and my time is limited, therefore. But what we had before, this was work of Olga. She always found a phase transition in her singing crystals of manganese to rhodium 10, and some of our physicists said this is 30 samples. go back, and she made it again and again, and just double. And so finally, she, without asking me even, she made some neutron data analysis, and at the same time, we computer did some calculation and said, it doesn't work, the magnetization doesn't fit to any calculation accounting rule. So we found out, finally, with Jürgen's help, so this is a non-collinear structure. This material, which later goes into the ferrimagnetic. So the moment is larger because we don't have a fully ferrimagnetic canceling here. So the other way to see it also was with AC, so selectivity measurement. And this has a local moment, and you see as a in direction of different direction. So which means the x direction is the deviation of the manganese moment. So you see over a certain temperature, then it goes to zero, so we have the normal Heusler structure with a high moment on one manganese. This is on top of the equal sign, and the lower moment for the other manganese, up and the voltage. Okay, so we found in this material an anomalous Heusler effect, and some predictions were done for experiments in this material. So I have, again, Andrea, if you see something interesting coming up, he immediately jumps on this, and he has grown very nicely in crystals, this time, again, in his system, manganese platinum tin, so which is also a non-collinear structure in this material, again, the spectra was predicted also by Siri, and he found this very nice transition also in his non-collinear structure, just at the transition between these two structures, which is very typically was also found for manganese silicon, and so on for susceptibility for spermium system. So he did nice investigation in Lawrence Tam, and I think this is still ongoing work. So this is a non-collinear structure at low temperature, then above where's the phase transition at, so 20 Kelvin, and then above the phase transition at 300 Kelvin, it's a different non-collinear structure. And here you see nicely how this non-collinear structures changes, so here as in between here is much nicer, it's much better ordered. And here you can easily imagine how you get the spermion structure here, and this is exactly as well like it, because this is a two domain one spermion at the edges, which appears here, and then it survives even at larger field. Okay, so the other thing is we started also to like this a hexagonal distortion, and we did some calculation on this, and during the plan he published a paper in 2014 for this system. At the same time, and McDonald has published a paper in PRL, so we had to hurry up, because we have seen he worked on manganese uranium, which Stuart likes, but we like only relatives of Heusler, so we worked on manganese uranium and tin. So we found out that this compound, even if it's here it's wrongly drawn, here it was a, if you assume some ferrimagnetic arrangement, but finally this compound has really a nice anti-ferromagnetic arrangement, which is side-decanted, so we did some calculation of the very curvature for this, because this helped us to understand whether there is an anomalous Heusler effect, and at this time we were very much interested in this chiral structures, and Jürgen Kübler found a baryon curvature in this paper, and so we published that along the KZ plane, we have a non-vanishing baryon curvature. So we have grown the single crystal, and we worked for a long, long time on this because we had debates with domains and chirality and Stuart and so on, which were endless. Everybody can imagine endless discussion. And then, so we had all this data, so showing really that we have a huge anomalous Heusler effect in this material, much larger than expected, larger in the same cobalt manganese iron silicon, which was also calculated in a nice agreement with what we have measured later with the mining group together. So this was surprising. And we have, it's also very much depending from the measurement direction, because as I said, the baryon curvature is large in one plane, and this is due to wild points, and at this time we were not so much in the wild point, wild semi-metal business. Nowadays we are very much in the wild semi-metal. So when we published this with Kübler, so we were discussing, and finally a paper showed up on, on the next slide, in Nature, and we were surprised that some Japanese group has done a very nice job on manganese 310, which has a much slower values than our conductivity. And you nicely see that you can change it as a function of the degree. Also, it's really strongly related to the orientation. So we have a slight tangent along out of the AME plane, but you see exactly where we have the very curvature, we find a very huge value in the power conductivity. It goes in the order of magnitude like the quantum Hall effect. We have not used this as a setting point, but anyway, the Japanese group has done it. And they published this paper, and after we then have put our paper very fast on the compound, it was as exciting as a whole topological insulators and rising metals business, so fight against each other on the compound. They immediately published another paper on the compound yesterday night. So they have done also nice work on magnetism, germanium, showing also much larger values than they have observed even in this nature paper, which has appeared 2 weeks ago. So, as you see, there's still a lot to do with Heusler compounds, and this is now we have a nice tree. So there's still a lot of to do, and I think maybe we wait for the measurement of the spin Hall effect and the quantum spin Hall effect and so on in Heusler compounds and